Good. Thank you guys so much for having me. I'm really excited about the group of people that we've been able to bring together in the room today. If I'm completely honest, my two favorite groups of people to hang out with, people doing technology and people doing development research and accumulating evidence. So I'm pumped about this group. And in thinking about what we could do,
This work?
In thinking about sort of how I can be helpful in pushing that conversation along about how we can collaborate to hasten the end of extreme poverty, I wanted to tell you a bit about what we've been doing over the last few years at GiveDirectly and more recently at a tech venture called Segovia that I've been helping to get up off the ground. But I think I wanted to pull it back and end with a couple of broader themes. So let me tell you the story, but then let me use it as a lens to try to present two lessons. I think things that Anne-Marie has already hit on pretty hard as well, so nice to see some consistency emerging. So GiveDirectly got started when the co-founders and I were in grad school doing PhDs in development economics. And at the time, we were trying to figure out where we wanted to give our own money, you know, on the optimistic assumption that we would actually get gainful employment someday. So we were looking at this classic problem of, you know, what do you do as a donor to help the extreme poor living abroad? And as we looked into this, what we found is that for the typical donor based here in the US, the system through which we deliver help to the extreme poor is quite complex, and it looks something like this. So the typical setup would be there's an international organization, you know, headquarters here in the US that provides management functions and fundraising functions that we give to. They're then gonna work with local NGOs on the ground in the emerging markets who are gonna coordinate and manage the provision of goods and services to the poor. And they're gonna work together with that international organization to figure out what those goods and services ought to be. So I have a few reactions to this system. I think there are some potentially good things about it and some reasons why it might be, in some cases, the right way to go. But there are also some things that I think we found very frustrating about it. And I think at the core is the fact that it's very hard to figure out the cost effectiveness of whatever your dollar is going to go to. And there are two key reasons for that. The first is that it's actually hard to figure out what your dollar is going to go to. Because this is a complex enough system, it's very difficult to make any statement about on the margin if I give a dollar, where is it going to go? And I think in many cases, if we're honest, the people running the system, we don't know either. On top of that, the second issue is that even if you knew where it was going to go, we have far too little of the rigorous experimental evidence that places like CEDAR are now starting to produce to tell us what the impacts are on the lives of the people that we're trying to help. So we felt dissatisfied with this system, but at the same time, I think we're entirely sure what the alternative might be. And then through our work in grad school, kind of became exposed to two kind of mega trends that we felt like had the potential to completely reshape the way we think about giving. The first of these, which you've heard a little bit about already, was advances in last mile payments. And Karthik, who I work with in India, is actually gonna get up and talk in depth in the next talk about some of the improvements in India that are based on biometric authentication, which is what I've shown you here. Of course, many of you also heard about breakthroughs in mobile payments, which have been getting a lot of attention. But the bottom line is, whatever the tech platform, globally, our ability to connect directly to the extreme poor has improved dramatically in the last 10 years. It's possible to put money effectively into bank accounts for extremely poor people in a way that just wasn't true in the past. And so intuitively to us, it felt like there's power in that change and that potential. The second big change was, and you've heard about this already a bit, that back around 15 years or so ago, development economists started to kind of do experimental science, shockingly for the first time. So we had been doing development economics for a really long time, but it wasn't until quite recently that we started to do A/B testing, right, as you guys would call it. And it's kind of crazy because, you know, I think to myself all the time, if I were here at Google and I went into the C-suite and said we're going to propose a change to the search algorithm, and you'd say, you know, well, what do we know about the effects that's going to have? And I said, well, you know, we haven't done any testing, but we have this really great theory of change. Right? But literally, that's the way we've been doing development economics for such a long time. And so then along came Jay Powell and some of these new institutions at SIGA and started pushing us to test our ideas in the field. And so what we found when we started testing these things, and it's great about doing experimental science, is, you know, that there are surprises. Right? So some of the things that we thought were gonna work really well, turned out they didn't. And some of the things that we thought wouldn't work that well turned out to work really well. And this very simple notion of cash transfers, of just giving money directly to the extreme poor and letting them decide how to use them, was one of those things I put in the ladder bucket that turned out to work a lot better than most people would have expected. So there's no way to synthesize all the evidence, everything that we've learned about cash transfers over the last 10, 15 years. I put up a map here with a bunch of green dots to give you some sense of the geographic coverage and the extent to which we've now done this experimental testing. I've also called out some of the studies that were done by folks here at SIGA, just to acknowledge the important role SIGA has played in building that evidence base, including studies across a range of continents, Exciting work from Malawi showing the impacts on teenage pregnancy and school attendance and HIV. Exciting work from Mexico showing the impacts on long-term income and earnings and standards of living. But the bottom line was that across the board, when we read this evidence, we were seeing that, you know, A, the most negative stereotypes, like they're just gonna blow it on booze or gambling, just simply were not borne out in the data. And B, that, you know, depending on the context, you see people using money in different ways, but consistently in ways that are improving their lives. And in some cases, having really dramatic long-term impacts on their standards of living. So we now have for cash transfers, you know, coming back to that earlier question about long-term, right? It's very rare that we have long-term evidence on anything. I think the deworming study here at CICA is probably the longest running study. It's out 12 years now, is that right? Which is just remarkable. For cash transfers, we have evidence out 4 or 5 years in a few cases, and seeing people's earnings go up in the range of 40 to 80% per annum, right, of the amount that they receive. It's a really big long-term impact. So we looked at that evidence, and we looked at what's happening with payments, and we said, I mean, you guys can kind of do the math from there, right? You put those two things together. We said, we have this complicated system, but, you know, couldn't we have something much simpler, which would look like this? So that's what we built at KidDirect. And, you know, conceptually it is trivial and it's sort of funny to laugh about, but logistically it's quite difficult. And that's really what I wanted to spend the kind of meat of our time today talking about, is how you actually go about doing this, because it's hard work. The reason I'm so excited about it is twofold. I think, first of all, there's a huge opportunity just looking at U.S. federal giving. So Americans give something like $20 billion a year, conservatively, to international giving every year. And a lot of that, you know, if we're honest with ourselves, we give through these fairly antiquated systems, and we give on a whim because things seem cool or exciting. So we think there's a real opportunity to shift that and shift it towards more efficient and more effective things like cash transfers. And so GiveDirect has been growing quickly. I think we'll come in this year and maybe in the 40 to 50 million range for revenue. And we're really excited about sort of reshaping that market and hopefully provoking some really good cognitive dissonance, getting people to sort of re-examine some of those stereotypes that may be guiding the way they think about poverty. You know, classic lines like teach a man to fish, right? Sort of pithy little phrases that sort of contain no real insight into the impact. But the second thing that really excites me about this is, if you know, do the math and add up how much it would take to get everybody from where they are right now to $1.25 a day, right? Imagine that we could perfectly target those people. People who've been doing this in DC tell us that it's probably something in the ballpark of $65 billion a year. So that's a lot of money, right? But it's less than we give in terms of ODA. It's about half of ODA every year. It's much less than what emerging market governments spend on their anti-poverty programming. I'll go out on a limb and say that it's less than is currently wasted because of poor decision-making or fraud or corruption in the current system. So what that means is that this end of extreme poverty that Anne May and the folks at USAID are talking about, from a purely fiscal perspective, that is totally within our reach, right? That is very doable. The two things that we're lacking to do that are the will to set aside some of these pet projects and these more wasteful approaches and inefficient approaches, and then the logistics to actually get the money into poor people's hands. So that's what I find so motivating about this logistical challenge, right? And I think what's driven a lot of the work at GiveDirectly and at Segovia. So I'll tell you a bit about what we do and explain to you why it was that we decided, after having created this, you know, all the work done to create one startup in the nonprofit space, we then decided to do all the work to create a second startup, providing technology for that first startup to use. What I mapped out here on the left-hand side of the screen is the sort of, at a high level, the process that GiveDirectly uses to enroll recipients and transfer money to them. And, you know, I'll talk a bit about our specific process, but this is truly a generic thing, right? Any sort of transfer program around the world, whatever it is providing, whether it's food, money, to the poor, has, or at least one would hope it should have, these four steps in the process. So the first thing is actually targeting. It's identifying who is poor and deciding who you want to be eligible for the program. The second step is auditing that list. So you have an initial list and you're worried that perhaps people have been putting their cousins on the list and you want to check. The third step is the actual transfer of the resources. And there's, of course, a lot of authentication in there, making sure that the right people are getting the food or the money, whatever it is. And then the last step is the monitoring. It's the follow-up to find out whether things are actually working, to identify things that are broken, to jump in and fix, to get feedback from people. So at GiveDirectly, we had begun to build all of these things, and we had digitized them and sort of streamlined them to the extent possible. But I think what really struck us as we started getting towards scales, you know, $10, $20 million a year of throughput, you know, where it became a serious management challenge, right? And the amount of money we could potentially lose at one stroke if somebody were to upload the wrong Excel file got really big, is that there really is nothing more secure, more robust, right, than literally managing these things out of Excel. Right? In the worst case, it's still pencil and paper. We're capturing data in the field and then data centering it after that. In the best case, we might be capturing data electronically on digital devices, but we certainly aren't getting any of the advantages of control and security that you get with a real enterprise platform, right? The way you want to manage data in your business, right? And we certainly aren't getting any of the benefits of modern analytics, right? The ability to put all your data in one place and then learn across it and spot patterns that might not be obvious to the human eye. And we certainly don't have secure interfaces with the external parties, like with the payments vendors that you want to make sure that you aren't exposed to some of those massive fraud risks. So we looked at that and we looked at what we wanted. We decided that, you know, it didn't exist. And so in the same way that with GiveDirectly, we built something so that we could use it, we were gonna do something similar with Segovia, which is this tech venture that we've now started, along with my co-founder, Michael, at GiveDirectly. And so Segovia is an integrated platform that provides all of those things, and that we hope will move social programming into the sort of the modern digital age. I'll walk through each step and sort of explain a little bit as we go what's involved in each step, and then sum up. So with the targeting step, it's, you know, about capturing data digitally, which I think is not that surprising. All the staff are out in the field with Android devices that cost about $100 capturing those data. And, you know, so there's some mundane benefits from doing this, obviously, things like fewer typos, fewer fat finger mistakes, faster processing and turnaround, which are great. But I think there are a lot of other things which are less obvious initially, and which I'd actually highlight. Things like we get the data back at the end of the day, and you see the time pattern of responses, and you can make management decisions based on those. So one of the funny examples we had is we had some folks who went out, did some work on a Saturday, and then said they had to go back on Monday to finish up, and uploaded data to the server at the end of the day on Monday. But the great thing about digital capture is those data are timestamped, and so you see that they were actually recorded on Saturday. And then those data are linked to phone numbers, so you can route that to the call center and talk to the people they worked with in the field, and it turns out, yeah, that those people met with someone from GiveDirectly on Saturday. Right, so what you have is a case of someone who tried to do some work on Saturday and then claim a day of pay on Monday for work they didn't actually do. It's little things like that, right? So you never capture that in a world of pencil and paper entry. You can capture that when you have everything stamped with time and location importance and things like that. At the next step, the audit step, we just rolled out the second version now of Segovia and started putting the monitors up in our office in New York, and it's just been incredible, I think, for the team in terms of morale to have a sense of what's happening day to day. But, you know, we're now in a world where we come in the morning and see what happened in Uganda, in Kenya the day before. And to give you a sense of the kinds of things you can do, here's a map. Each of the pins on this map is a recipient who was enrolled yesterday. And then they're color-coded to correspond to the identity of the person on our team who did the work, right, who went door-to-door. And so you can see these interesting things, like some people take a very linear, systematic path through the village, and some people are just all over the map. I don't know what it is. Maybe they have somebody they like to hang out with, or they're not paying attention. But you have a little guy down here, right, so we need to kind of figure out what this was. It doesn't look like it's part of the program, right? And so we're now literally in a world where we can pick up the phone. I can pick up the phone and call my field directors in Uganda and ask questions about these data as they come in. Which just gives you a much better sense and a much tighter control over what's happening in the field. The third step, the transfer step, we talked about a little bit. And, you know, we started in Kenya for the obvious reason that Kenya has M-Pesa. And I think it's right to really praise and recognize M-Pesa for everything it's accomplished. I mean, certainly in terms of penetration and familiarity, it's just incredible. Something like, I think, the last that I've seen was 90% of Kenyan adults have used M-Pesa at least once. And it's been brilliant for us because it means that our beneficiaries, when they receive cash from GiveDirectly, have a lot of options. You know, if they have a bad experience at one M-Pesa agent, they can go somewhere else. You know, somebody tries to ask them for a bribe. Things like that are really powerful. But even M-Pesa, from a technical standpoint, you know, we're still like literally holding our breaths as we speak today, waiting for their API, right? And they launched in 2007, right? So the best of the best. And so, you know, what we had to do at Segovia is figure out what do you do in a world like that where even with the best of the best, your interfaces aren't going to be very secure, aren't going to be very well defined, might change. And no joke, 2 weeks ago, they changed the upload form for GiveDirectly, and so things went out of whack for a couple of days. We had to sort of rejigger our CSV output. So it's about tackling challenges like that where you can't count on connectivity and you can't count on a stable interface with your vendor, but you want to be sure that you're secure, right, and that you're not issuing payments by having a junior staffer email over a CSV file to someone giving instructions to issue, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars worth of payments. So that's Kenya. Uganda, I won't even get started. You guys can ask me. And then finally on monitoring, I think this is one of the ones that I feel most passionately about because we talk a lot about the excitement of getting that first mobile device into the hands of a poor family and what it could do for them. And we tend to think about things like payments. And I think that's very exciting, but I also think that the raw ability to talk to people is potentially even more important. So one thing we've done in GiveDirectly is make sure that everybody who wants a phone can get one by making it easy for them to buy one and have the price taken out of their cash transfer. And the reason that we do that is because it lets us connect with folks afterwards and assess how we're doing and catch problems in a really systematic way. So we've been in touch by phone with about 99% of the people that we've sent money to. And we use that feedback for everything from sort of more strategic problem solving, identifying areas we need to get better as an organization, to at the very individual level, providing feedback to our staff and helping to evaluate their performance. And the reason I'm so excited about that second piece is that so much of development fieldwork comes out to this dispersed workforce that's moving across the map to remote areas where it's really hard to tell if they're delivering a high quality, respectful experience to people who are trying to serve. If they're staying on message when we're delivering a complicated public health message, for example. And so what the call center has let us do is to measure that systematically and then reward people on our team who are doing a good job of it. So one of the things we'll do through the call center is ask recipients to explain the program back to us. Right? It's like playing a game of telephone to our workers and to the recipients. And then if you work for me and the people that you enrolled do a good job of answering those questions, explaining the program, then you're going to get paid more, you're more likely to get promoted, right? Because it feeds into your performance review. So these are very nitty-gritty things, but I think they're the kinds of things, the kinds of feedback loops that we really need to create, right, in order to build effective organizations. And I think it's really at that intersection between organization and management and tech where Segovia has been exciting for us. Two more things that Segovia have let us do that sort of speak to the broader themes of today around transparency, and then I'll wrap up. This is just a view of our homepage, which kind of, you know, mainly tells you that we like white space and are fairly minimalist aesthetically. But the thing that I think is cool here is that because all the data are now sitting in this enterprise platform, because they're queryable, we're able to pipe through and show you our key performance indicators, which are right here on the right-hand side, in real time. So at the same time as I'm looking at the performance of my field director in Kenya and assessing how well they're doing, you guys can look. And if they're failing on some metric, you can call and ask us what's going on. Right? And so it's literally, for me, come to the point where I have some more detailed dashboards that I look at, but I often manage just directly from the landing page of our website. We feel like, in terms of transparency in this industry, that that's a really exciting bar to set, right? Because transparency historically has meant things like I share my Form 990 with you, right? Or I have a good auditor or something like that. Or I report these sort of vague concepts of overhead, program services, and fundraising, whatever, and I try to keep fundraising low, right? That's kind of what transparency means. This means like we could actually make a mistake and you would see it, and you see it at the same time that we would. We think that's a powerful standard to set. Further down the line, I think we want to push it further, and we also want to humanize it a little bit. So we're known for being quantitative to an extreme. Some people might almost say inhumanly quantitative. And I think it's been great because it's let us connect with donors who are really like us, who come from a very analytical background. But even those donors will say, look, you know, we're putting bets on people here. Right? When you give a cash transfer, you're investing in someone. And you're watching to see what happens to their life. And some of those stories are going to turn out really well. You know, we've had incredible success stories. We've had people who've done things we never would have predicted, and others haven't. You know, there are people who have rebuilt their house and then the house burned down and they ended up back where they started. And that's reality, right? So we would love to be able to present that reality to people in an unfiltered way. I think the way stories get used typically in nonprofit marketing, what's bad is not the stories. The stories are a really powerful medium to help us understand other people's lives. But what's bad is the cherry picking. Right? It's picking a few things that aren't representative and saying, this is what happens when you fund our NGO. So we're in a great position because we have this complete vertical integrated supply chain. We can actually deliver these stories to you in an unfiltered way. And so that's something that we want to do down the road and are working on right now as we speak. With that in mind, I'll sort of switch gears and say that while that might be the sexiest thing we're planning on doing at GiveDirectly, I think for me, one of the big takeaways from this whole experience has been that we really need to prioritize investment in unsexy technology, right? I think, you know, I was thinking about some of the things that Anne May talked about. There's some things that you could easily see being a great TED talk, right? I think the Ebola suit, for example, which I could definitely, even I could give a TED talk about the Ebola suit. That would be awesome. I don't think Segovia makes a good TED talk, frankly. Right? I also don't think that Microsoft Office makes a good TED talk. But it's a damn useful piece of technology. And so I think that, you know, just as Anne May said, we tend to gravitate towards things that are punchy, that provide good headlines. But I think there's a lot of this backbone infrastructure stuff that's not glamorous. But that's where, if you really care about returns, about impact, that's where a lot of it is likely to be. And I think Karthik will talk about a great example of this next. I'll hand over to him. The second big thing is sort of to this point about lean development and feedback. I think One thing that I love about this whole story is the feedback loop that we've seen between evidence and technical investment. So when we got started with GiveDirect and then ultimately with Segovia, because of all this evidence that had been done at SIGA and elsewhere about the impact that cash was having, which motivated us to get up and start building. But I think the flip of that is that we're now at a place in terms of technical capacity where we can really push the limits of impact evaluation. So we're doing stuff now. So Ted and one of his students at Berkeley and I are working on an impact evaluation where we're going to be moving about $15 million and randomizing the villages that get that money, and then looking at the impacts that has on community level economic outcomes, on enterprise structure and price dynamics. And working at that scale just wouldn't be possible, right? I wouldn't feel comfortable moving $15 million without a real enterprise platform backing it. That gives me that reassurance that the money's actually going where we think it ought to be. And so I think those feedback loops are important, and again, that comes back to why I think this group of people is a great group of people to have together. Thanks.
We have time for probably three or four questions.
Sounds great.
So one of the challenges with sourcing funding through this traditional model of giving it to the New York NGO to then give it to local NGOs is the fundraising part of it is oftentimes driven by non-rational things. You know, maybe that the best fundraisers are doing it because they are really good at printing glossy annual reports that have pictures of smiling kids.
Yep.
Have you looked at measuring what the impact on giving is? When you're routing it differently, instead of routing it through one of these, you know, by choose for poor kids versus we're just going to send it directly through, because you could imagine that even if you're more efficient, if you're raising less money, you know, it could wash out.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I'd say a few things. First, I think the whole approach in terms of communication that nonprofits have taken with kind of fundraising and marketing, I find very bizarre. And what I mean by that is that, you know, we sort of accepted the narrative that it's a bad thing and we're going to do as little as possible, but we have to do a little bit. Sorry about that. And, you know, our numbers are we spend about 3 cents per dollar raised right now. We basically haven't marketed it directly at all. That's kind of 2015 priority number one. Even an organization that's sort of about average is spending maybe 10 cents per dollar raised. And if that's a strong evidence-backed intervention, then I'd love to have my money spent on fundraising, right? Because you're telling me that you can take a dollar and turn it into $10, right? That's like an incredibly leveraged opportunity. So I think there's a real basic disconnect about how we talk about that. Second, I think, and this is, I think, part of your point, it's really critical to know like where that money would have gone otherwise, right? Like if you take this sort of counterfactual mentality seriously, the same way that we do on the impact side, you say, what would have happened if we hadn't given? I think, you know, as a fundraiser, I really want to know, what would you have given to if you hadn't given to me? And I think we almost never ask that question. So, you know, one of the things that we're working through is how do we do that in a systematic way? Ideally, we'd like to raise money from people that would have bought Ferraris or would have given to something really, really crazy like goats or something like that, right? And I don't want to be stealing too much money from the chlorine dispensers. Right? I'll take a bit of it, but so I think that's the second big thing we've been thinking about. And then I think the third question I take away from your comment is sort of, you know, just how much optimism can we have, right? What's realistic to expect? And I think that's a fair push. And I think we're realistic that to kind of reach a really broad audience, there will have to be much more emotional content and much more human connection. And honestly, I think there's a lot of good in that as well, because I think part of what's happened over the years is that, you know, nonprofits present us with this very stylized image of what poverty is like. And sometimes it's a positive stereotype of a microfinance client. Sometimes it's a negative one of the victim of a disaster or something like that. But I think we have this great opportunity to kind of, for millennials, to give them the kind of the authentic, unspun version of it, which I think would be great. But you know, it is a bet. I think the things I point to say, you know, let's feel good first is that when you look at retail fundraising, child sponsorship has been the dominant success model, the thing that has raised organizations hundreds of millions of dollars a year. And I think second that, you know, nobody really has the opportunity to do it digitally in the same way, with the whole end-to-end infrastructure and the digital platform. So those are the things that, you know, make me think it's worth my time.
So I think what you've done is really fantastic, and I just have come from being at USAID, and so I really welcome these kinds of innovations. To the point about the transparency about what's happening, which I also think is fantastic, We know that not all the money will be that somebody rebuilt their house and burned it down. There'll be stuff that we aren't necessarily proud of what they did with it. And so I would love you to think through, having been hauled in front of Congress when we invented DIV, for one that they thought was a failure but wasn't, how we might think about and respond to those kinds of things taken out of context that will shut this sort of new innovation down, and how we all can support that.
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. My answer, I'd almost say let's chat afterwards. Some of the stuff that I'm most excited about that we've been doing with USAID and in partnership here with folks at Google.org, I think sort of is built to speak directly to this. It's not quite finished. So technically speaking, I'm not meant to answer your question publicly. But you know, I think you're totally right. In sort of broad sense, it's about de-risking something that's new and risky, like cash transfers for people, you know, the folks working in Legis Affairs and the folks working with their counterparts on the Hill, thinking about what could that one bad headline look like, and you know, what's the risk of it sort of money being used to buy a weapon or something like that? How do we manage all of that? I think the one thing I can say at the abstract level is that having the sort of feedback and monitoring that we have in place is super helpful for that, because we are on the phone with literally everybody who gets the money. And so we can ask any question you want, we can prepare, you know, any analysis you want. And I think that does provide some level of reassurance. I think the more detailed answer, we should probably just talk offline. And I'd love to pick your brain.
You mentioned some amazing rates of return from the recipients of these cash transfers. What are they doing with it to get these rates of return?
Yeah, it's a great question. And one of the funny things that's happened as a result of all this research is that people have sometimes asked that question and then said, oh, we should do that. I think so I'll take a couple of the examples. So the Northern Uganda study by Chris Blattman, Nate Fiala, and co-authors, I think that's probably the closest to what we do, both in terms of kind of the size of the grants, the targeting, and then the geographic part of the world. And so, you know, when I talk to Chris and I've read the paper carefully, I think it's there's a range of things, you know, that is kind of part of the point that there is no one thing. But I'd say it's the bulk of it capital investment. It's sort of people who had some kind of skilled trade they want to practice but didn't have the tools to do it. Could be something like being a barber or a welder or something like that. And then I think mixed in with that, there is a bit of soft skill as well. There's a bit of human capital investment. People will do things like apprentice themselves out or pay someone to come and provide training in an occupation to a bunch of people in the village. For me, that was one of the more interesting takeaways from this. That, you know, I didn't really know that those markets existed. And it turns out they do, and I think it's worth reflecting on when we think about the whole teaching a man to fish thing, that, you know, there are actually fishing lessons commercially available, and people are choosing whether or not they want to get those fishing lessons, and are our fishing lessons really any better? It would be a worthwhile thing to reflect upon. So that's one example. Another one from Sri Lanka, I think this is a context where people were very much rebuilding existing enterprises after the tsunami hit. So I think those are areas where you're likely to see really high returns, because people have kind of plans or business models or things that were working before, and it literally just had a big chunk of their capital stock wiped away. So those are areas where I think it's kind of a pretty obvious win.
Okay, I think that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.